Vi är en konspiration på spåren. Det är möjligt att gruppen som samlas här för att avveta en bättre middag och diskutera resultatet av sitt arbete ryggar tillbaka lite inför benämningen. Men om vi använder ordbokens härledning, konspirera, att andas tillsammans, så stämmer det rätt bra. För det här är forskare från Göteborgs universitet och Chalmers tekniska högskola. Det är musiker och praktiker från två kontinenter. Och i 10 år har de andats tillsammans. Och i 5 av de 10 åren har de byggt ett säreget instrument. En orgel framställd som vore det för 300 år sedan. Ett nästan alkemiskt försök att blåsa liv i en uttunnad tradition. Och för att låta oss lyssna till ett ljud som inte hörts på 3 sekel.
But not in the edges.
This is an interesting lesson that you learn from such a trumpet. And it's really rather well preserved.
But when you play...
Okay.
Det fanns 2 anledningar att leta förebilder i just norra Tyskland. Dels låg här de rika städer vars makt byggdes upp under Hansatiden och där orgeln var en symbol för den politiska och kulturella kraften. Med sin storlek, sin klang och sin konstnärliga utformning gav den ett multimedialt budskap om makt och förmåga. Och här levde och verkade den största byggaren av dem alla, Arp Schnitger, heter han. Och i den här kyrkan köpte han sig en gravplats rakt under helvetet. Det finns bara en hake i det här. Ingen orgel finns kvar i original. De flesta har bytts till och bytts om allt eftersom smaken har ändrats. Ibland ganska brutalt. Ungefär som att göra en elplanka av en Stradivarius.
Here we have the wooden pipes and the boost positive. You'll see the modern pipes here in the front. They look quite ugly. And behind it you have the pair of wooden flutes, the gedeckt and the block flöter. And this is the oldest example of what Schnittger did later in his boost positive divisions. And the gedeckt is a very elegant sound rather narrow scaled, and then it is a perfect continuous stop. Stop that Schnitger built all his life in the Brustpositiv, and it is a spectacular open flute sound.
Dann erlebt, das ist. Moment.
In Schweden macht man das mit einem Rrrr.
Ja, natürlich.
Ja.
Thank you. The overall idea of an instrument like this indeed is a vision that you have in the beginning, and you follow this vision all the way through. And therefore I think it works so fine, because everybody is somehow hooked to this vision also in the shop. But then when you start doing it, then it comes to the details, and this also works fine. And so we have to have these both aspects, the vision and the details, and you have to put this together.
I'm holding Finn Lohmiel. You might wonder why this has anything to do with organ building.
Det gäller att leta, alltså. Det gäller att använda alla tillgängliga tekniker för att se hur, försöka utröna hur de gjorde. För vi kan ju bara se resultatet av deras arbete och sen kan vi försöka att reproducera och se om vi kan komma så nära som möjligt.
Then people thought, oh, this was cast on sand because it looks like the sand imprint. But to tell you the truth, this is not cast on sand. This was cast on cloth. So this is a sort of interesting antithesis I'm going to present. I'm not trying to deny the casting on the sand in 17th century, because there are enough evidence to tell us that sand was used, particularly early part of the 17th century. But already in the beginning of the 18th century, there are discussions about the casting on cloth. Now, but you can still make the surface like this. When I started to use the old style cloth, like this one, and particularly, I used this rogue mule. There is a description that in early 18th century that organ builders used the flower in some cases. So I thought it was a little crazy, but we tried it. And certainly we succeeded to make the surface just look like the metal cast in 17th century. Pure lead, in the 20th century definition of a pure lead and 16th century pure lead behaves quite differently. So that's what we have to try one at a time and try to create these limitations they had and then learning from it and try to recreate the tools and the equipment and the materials and then after a while I can still never get to this the final look, the same final look. So then we have to think, well, okay, there must be something else we are doing wrong. Or they had some other element they had to deal with. So that's the sort of process of learning. Breath of the pipe.
Also in music making, it's one of my concepts. First do it, then understand it. And our system that has been developed in the 19th century more or less, or the early 20th century, was somehow the opposite. First explain it, then understand it. Do it. First explain it, then do it. And it should be the other way around. And this is exactly what happens when people relate to, let's say, the organ. They cannot understand the organ. The organ is so complex that it takes a long time to understand what's really going on in an organ.
Ja,
vi har detta problemet att när vi jobbar på andra tekniska system så är vi ganska vana vid att man har specifikationer. Man talar om vilket är det högsta tillåtna trycket och vilket är det lägsta. Och det är vår utgångspunkt att hålla systemen mellan dessa då. Det finns inte här. Så vi har alltså diskussioner, kraftfulla, vänliga diskussioner med musikhögskolan om att tolka detta begreppet. Vad är levande luft och vad är rätt dynamik. Men jag kan inte bedöma. Men det jag kan säga då att om man gör om det här på ett riktigt bältsystem och trycket sjunker ner så här, så är det en effekt av masterighetsmomentet i systemet. Och vill man ha bort den effekten, då ska man påverka det. Det kan jag säga.
Samtidigt blottlades pipornas mikrostruktur och sambandet mellan materia och klang av Milan Friesel, och han hittade dessutom det sandkorn inbäddat i ett barockt metallfragment som slutgiltigt visade att den tidens pipor göts på sand. Och Mendel Kleiners akustiska modellförsök av orgelns framtida miljö i Örgryte nya kyrka följdes av forskning om pipors gemensamma resonans och om psykoakustik.
Med nordiska delegater, 120 stycken, och efter en kort prestation under en lunch så var de eld och lågor, tog till sig det här, alltså berätta om att men det här är ju så, det är ju faktiskt något som förenar oss i europeiska länder, oilar har vi och ja, visst, de vill vi ju värna om, och sen finns det här med forskningen också kring det då, va? Så jag tror att det, även om det kan verka lite sådär som att man som orgelentusiast kommer med någon idé om att orgeln skulle vara symbol för Europa, så finns det så att säga historiskt relevans i det här då, och det, man, jag tror man söker efter någonting som just kan sammanföra människor med olika kompetenser och över nationsgränserna idag, så att det symboliska värdet tror jag verkligen ligger där.
The mechanical part of the instrument, and it's more than just the mechanical parts that work, but organ is a good term for it. It's a living mechanism. There's the smell, there's the feel of the keys, the smell of the leather, and of course the sound of the instrument, and then the beauty of the wood and the carvings and whatever. So all of that goes together, so it's much more than just the musical experience. And as I often tell people, because I'm interested in mechanical things, it's that alone made it a fun project for me, just to see something like that created. friend of mine was active in the John Ernst Foundation, and he heard about this organ project, and because the head of the Ernst Foundation, Mr. Kaufman, was interested in organs and organist. So they asked me to come along and just, I'm not involved with the foundation, but just come and take a look at it. And I took one look at the people that were involved and what they were trying to do. And originally it was going to be a project in North Germany, as you probably know. And then that kind of fell through. And then there was this opportunity in Gothenburg. And it sounded absolutely marvelous. It sounded perfect in terms of, especially when they were talking about trying to duplicate the casting methods for making the metal. And this is the kind of thing that always needs to be done, because it's trying to duplicate a technology that was done years ago and was superseded by something that in theory was simpler or easier or better, but was different. And so to be able to research and duplicate something as it was done years ago and replace basically a lost art was I thought, a fascinating concept.
Our interest is to enrich human endeavor. And we like to do it with people who can't even quite imagine where they're going. And we like to work with mavericks, in other words, people who aren't in the normal box. You saw that we haven't adopted the little box as a symbol, but that was our first attempt to draw a symbol of the foundation. And it's out of the box to a star.
In order to really inspire people and create innovators out of just students, people who can think creatively about new ways of doing things, a project of this kind can invite people to look into a subject in depth, the way the guild members of medieval times looked into depth in the subjects that they focused their entire lives on. And what we have here is a group of people who are stopping and giving a very sophisticated inquiry into a subject that is a little bit unique, wouldn't necessarily invite broad-based research in a general university environment. And because of its uniqueness and the focus and passion that people are giving to it, they're getting into a level of understanding that goes one step beyond that is ordinarily achieved in the typical research project, because it's not just pure science, it's also pure science and how it relates to art and culture and other aspects of the human experience.
In the 19th century, the genius is the ghost who is going above the material and brings life into the material. And now we return to this pre-rational artist concept. And one of the most important thing of this concept is that the results of this craftsmanship have to be used. Rembrandt did not produce l'art pour l'art. He just produced paintings. If you needed a painting, you went to Rembrandt and you gave him the order and he made it for you. And the same thing we see in the music of Johann Sebastian Bach. You can imagine that in his large family, he had to do his work, and maybe he was at one day just on the corner of the kitchen table. He had to write down quickly a piece of music. and it was just music to use, and that it is fantastic, and that it has a quality that millions of people in our days are listening to it and are moved by it. That is something maybe he didn't know. That was something which goes beyond the actual result at that moment. And that's the sort of mystic balance between information and quality. But on the other hand, we need the information because we know now that the alloy of the metal and the amount of trace elements are important to get the result we want.
Yes,
okay.
I'm sure that over 100 years people will recognize the results of our art as specific from the end of the 20th century. So we are not copying. We're just searching for quality.
I had a choice when I chose the career, just going into more established side and working as a worker, just but thinking about music and organ building, I already had a very strong interest in those things. But that can be, I can consider those matters as just a hobby. After participating in some political movement, sometimes, you know, going against the establishment, government, or established way of thinking. Yes, I could be a sort of professional political activist, and just to support myself doing some labor or something like that could be done, and I've seen many friends doing that. Or you change your idea 180 degrees, just becomes a big corporation's dog or government's dog. That's another way. I've seen many people who did that kind of change after graduating the college. Or I could be just a sort of escapee from the society, just thinking about this and not doing anything. So I had several choices in a career or way of life. But those students' political activity really came to the point that really to me it was I saw the limit. I saw the end of such violent activities. I wanted to do something the rest of my life.
Okay, thank you. Now let's hear the soprano range of the Gedacht 8 solo.
Check the volume again.
That is too loud.
Too loud. Yeah, okay. How is loudness and timbre? Speed? Okay. So. This is nice and dirtiness. I like to leave it.
So 8-4-2 and 8-4-2.
If I don't use right technique, even though you may achieve the right volume, but it start the other things start suffering, like speech or the timbre or some this liveliness, all these things. So, looks about right. Check this once again. It reduced a little bit, but it's still a little too bright, and the sound is a little unhealthy now. It's a little unhealthy. Not happy yet.
But there is a certain sequence you can go through still.
Yes.
Trying.
So it's just like what the doctors do. They diagnose certain things, and then knowing the condition of the patient, and then give certain medicine. And then call the patients back and then ask the symptom, how it changes and so on. And depending on that, doctor may change the medicine a little bit. Yeah, the same way.
How many pipes are there in this organ?
Over 4,000 pipes. So it,
and you go through them, scraping and hitting them with a hammer?
Yes, each one of them. Some of them are very born to be happy. Some of them are very stubborn and strong character and try to fight back against me.
When you learn so much about pipe interaction and pipe characteristics, do you also learn about human interaction and characteristics?
Well, yes, I have problem with that all the time. I mean,
your best friends are your pipes?
No. I like to have real living human friends, but whatever I have I experience with my own real life, with a friend, lover, different girls. What my children, or parents, and all this are very helping, very much helping to think about what to do on these pipes. So all what I have said about how to work on these pipes is something what I learned from my human relationship to the others. Yes.
I think this is a model of a future global culture, what happens here in this workshop. We are moving out of national cultures. We are moving also out of a European culture. We are moving towards a global culture. And so people from all over the world, and one of them, one of the leaders is Munetaka Yokota from Japan, are working together. And they, as I said, they get hooked to this vision. And this is something that is also very emotional to a certain degree. And so they harmonize. It is a harmony. And this is what we need. We need a harmony between people. Between people living on this side of the globe and the other side of the globe and in between. And this is such a model. And I'm very proud that this happens here.
Not by reading about it, not by writing about it.
I just wrote the first time.